So let's take a deep breath for a minute. And just kind of bring our energies into the room. We got a backup, live backup band outside. So we're gonna get a chance to have music of all types that's gonna be going on today. So all we have to remember is, in the Course in Miracles, you don't have to believe it, you don't have to accept it, and you don't have to welcome it. And how are you doing with that?
Good.
Pretty good. I think we're doing pretty good with not believing it, not accepting it, and not welcoming it.
Yes.
And some of the ideas, I don't know if you noticed it yet, but you may actively resist. And if you you have to read it to resist it. But if you read it, you'll find that there's some things in there that you will probably resist and that you'll find startling, like what I'm going to cover today. And today I'm going to cover this, continue with the section I started with last week with my back to basics section, which is the Holy Spirit's curriculum, chapter 12. And I'm going to start with the fourth paragraph in the Holy Spirit's curriculum, the judgment of the Holy Spirit. The judgment of the Holy Spirit. So what are we doing today? The judgment of the Holy Spirit. If there's anybody on either side of you that you have not met, would you introduce yourself to them so we can get out of the mode of our representative? We are innocent. We are one. We are innocent. We are one. We are innocent. We are one. We are innocent. And hopefully you're also hugging some people you might need to forgive too. Yeah. Okay. All right. So let's start now. I'm going to do paragraph 4. I'm going to start with paragraph 4, chapter 12 of the Holy Spirit's curriculum, the first section, which says that it's on page 215. Absolutely, that's it. We're on page 215. And it says, there's nothing to prevent you from recognizing all calls for help. It's exactly what they are, except your own imagined need to kick butt, to attack, to be angry. So what I want to go back and say, well, the Course in Miracles says that there's only one judgment that a loving mind uses. That the loving mind only uses one judgment. A loving mind only uses one judgment. An awakened mind only uses one judgment. And that is that everything is love or a call for love, a call for help, or a call for healing. So everything is love or a call for love to a loving mind. To a loving mind, everything is love or a call for love. And the Course says the Holy Spirit is nothing but our loving mind. It's the part of our mind that's in touch with our higher power, and also the part of our mind that knows that there's a part of us that don't know what's going on, and is making it up as it goes along. Okay, so the Holy Spirit is the voice for God in us. It's the voice for truth in us. It's the part of us that's connected to source. So when I say Holy Spirit, I'm talking about the part of our mind that is pure love. That the part of our mind that doesn't do grievances, doesn't do fear, doesn't do attack, doesn't do lack thoughts. It's the part of our mind that knows that we are innocent and we're powerful and we're one and we're connected. That's the Holy Spirit. Look forward to meeting the Holy Spirit in myself one day. The other part of the mind is the part that's frantic, confused, disoriented, projects, attacks, thinks it's temporary, thinks it's the body, and thinks at some point that it ends its life here and is gone. That part that thinks it's a human being only. The Course calls that the ego, the fearful mind. Because obviously, if I've lost sight of my eternal identity, and I've lost sight of who I really am, and I've lost sight of the fact that I'm beautiful and powerful, then I'm going to be afraid. You know, so we just basically talking about what? Love and?
Call for love.
And call for love, which is love and fear. Okay, so this section is incredible. That's why I didn't want to just not get into it deeper. So it says, there's nothing to prevent you from recognizing all calls for love as exactly what all calls for love are, except your own imagined need to attack. And it's only your own imagined need to attack that makes you willing to engage in endless battles with reality. And how can you tell when you're engaged in a battle with the truth? where you deny the reality of the need for healing by making it unreal. Why would I not want to see your call for love and your call for help is real? I wouldn't do this except for my unwillingness to accept reality as it is. Now, what is reality? Reality is that it's all love or call for love. The truth is that it's all love or call for love. Why don't I want to accept that? Because I don't want to answer the call for love, I want to attack. And so the Course says the only problem with that is that when you don't accept reality as it is, you also withhold it from yourself. So if I want to create a reality where when I'm afraid or when I attack or when I do something that's potentially not cool, and I want people to see it as a call for help and a call for love, when I lose my friggin' mind and I'm not being as loving as I should be, then I have to see it that way with you. So if I don't see what you are doing as a call for love, if I don't see what you are doing as a call for help, then I'm withholding that from myself. And I'll tell you how. Your consciousness creates your reality. Your consciousness creates your reality. Your consciousness creates your reality. The way your mind works creates your reality. Everything you are experiencing it by right of consciousness. It's your consciousness, it's your mind that's creating your experience. It's your mind that's creating your experience. Did I say it was your mind that's creating your experience? Okay, it's your mind, it's your thoughts that are creating your experience. So whatever my consciousness is about, that's what I'm going to attract to myself, that's what I'm going to create. So if I have a consciousness that sees everything around me as love or a call for love, I will attract consciousness to me that sees everything as love or a call for love, so that when I am afraid and I'm hurting and I'm angry and I need love, I'll attract people to me when I lose my mind, who instead of getting mad at me and attacking me because I'm angry and acting crazy, they'll grab me and say, hey, what's going on? I'm here to support you, I'm here to nurture you, I'm here to help you get past this fear. Why? Because that's the way I see things, and so that's the way I develop my consciousness, and so therefore I attract that to me. So if I don't want to have compassionate people in my life, all I have to do is not be one. So when I don't want to see what you're doing as a call for love, I'm withholding that from myself. So when I am therefore angry and guilty, I won't see what I do as a call for love, and I won't be gentle with myself, and I won't draw people to me who are gentle with me. Does that make sense to everybody?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
So it's okay if you want to attack everybody, and it's okay if you don't want to see it as a call for love, and it's okay if you just want to get angry at what you think someone is doing to you. That's fine. You just attract a bunch of angry people to you. But if you really want to have that, those cool people, those loving beings, you want to be supported, then that's the kind of energy you need to put out there. Now, none of this is going to make sense if you don't believe that your consciousness and your thinking has nothing to do with your experience. So it's not going to work if you don't think your mind has anything to do with your reality. But if you're on a level of consciousness that you've gotten to the stage in your spiritual development that you believe thought is creative and your beliefs create your reality at any level, then this will make sense. If you have a metaphysical viewpoint, this will make sense. If you have a worldly viewpoint, nothing that I'm saying is going to make any sense. You don't think this is the craziest class that you ever came in, but at least it's different. Right? So even if it looks sounds, at least I'm not hearing something I hear every day, even if I think the guy's nuts. At least I'm here. Just make sure I can get out the door and I'm okay. I'll be, just don't block the door and I'll sit here with an open mind. You know? So then it goes on. So that paragraph is telling us, number one, the reason I don't want to see what you're doing as a call for love is because I want to attack you. You've done something and I just want to attack you back. I'm angry and I don't want to see what you're doing as a call for help. I want to see what you're doing as an opportunity for me to take vengeance on you because I'm mad at what I think you've done. Okay? The other thing that it tells us is that I am withholding the help and the compassion and the love from myself. That's the main reason why I don't want to see it that way. Because if I see what you do as a call for love, then I'm going to get my call for love answered. If I don't believe I deserve love, then I'm not going to want to do what the Course is saying because I want to make sure that I'm punished whenever I'm angry or I'm upset. So I'm really withholding the love from myself when I don't do this. So a person who doesn't love themselves are not going to do anything that's going to attract more love to themselves because they don't think they deserve it. So it's not really, I'm not willing to do this because I don't want to answer your call for love. The Course in Miracles says what the real deal is I don't want mine answered. That's why I don't want to practice it. Any questions or comments about that paragraph from anybody? you mean I did that fantastic a job of explaining it?
Yes.
I'm that good?
Yes.
Stop. Don't stop. Be careful. Joy will get rid of all your problems and you'll be happy. You know you don't want that. Don't do that. We don't play that game. You know, homie, don't play that. Okay, all right. Then I'll go to the next one then. Because this is really practical. Now, this next sentence is a trip. The next sentence says, it's surely good advice to tell you not to judge what you don't understand. This piece right here, so you can sit here too. I don't mind having you off to my side and in my back cupboard. I'll say it again. It's surely good advice to tell you not to judge what you don't understand. Don't judge what you don't understand. So when you come into a situation and you don't understand what's going on, don't judge it. It's because no one with a personal investment is a reliable witness. So if you want to get somebody to be a reliable witness about anything that's going on in your life, don't ask anybody that's got a personal investment in it. You don't ask your girlfriend if it's okay to go out to lunch with somebody else. That's a woman. You don't ask your boyfriend, is it okay to go out with the handsome guy that you met yesterday? Because in most cases, they got a personal investment. People with personal investments can't give you an objective viewpoint. So that's why you get the best advice sometimes from people you meet on an airplane. They have no personal investment in it whatsoever, so they can be objective. But if you ask your family about getting ready to move out of town, it's hard for them to have an objective viewpoint about that unless they've really been praying for years that you would leave town. but even then, that's still got a personal investment. But in this case, to you leaving, so it's still a personal investment. So I'll say it again, no one with a personal investment is a reliable witness. Everybody clear about that? I can't be objective if I've got an investment in the outcome. And then it goes on to say why? Because when you have a personal investment, then the truth to you is to the person with the personal investment, it's going to be what they want it to be. In other words, if I got a personal investment, I'm going to slant the truth in the direction of what I want the truth to be. That's why no one with a personal investment is a reliable witness. Then it goes on to say, if you are unwilling to perceive an appeal for help as what it is, an appeal for help, it's because you're unwilling to give help and to receive help. So if I don't want to see it as a call for help when you're acting crazy or you're afraid, then it's because I don't want to give help. Because if I saw what you were doing as a call for help, then I would feel maybe some type of an obligation to do something about it. If I don't see it as a call for help, then I don't have to give help. So really, the reason I don't want to see things as a call for help is because that person would be unwilling to give help. But that also means they're a person who's what? Unwilling to receive it. So a person that's unwilling to give it is also a person that's unwilling to receive it. If, you know, I don't wait for hugs. If I want a hug, I give it. Because if I give it, I'm receiving it immediately. If I want to have a conversation, I don't wait for people to come up and talk to me. I'll go up and talk to them because then I can have the conversation immediately. If I want a friendship, I just go up and talk to the person and introduce myself. If I don't want to go to lunch by myself, I invite somebody to go with me. Most people wait. They wait for someone else to always initiate whatever it is that they think that they want. So the court says to fail to recognize a call for help is to refuse help. So refusing help is when I won't recognize what you do as a call for help. That's refusing help. Now, would you maintain that you don't need help? Would you maintain that you don't need love? Would you maintain that you don't need healing?
No.
Well, that's what you're maintaining when you refuse to recognize somebody else's appeal and call for help. If I don't want to recognize your call for help, then the Course of Miracles says, I'm saying I don't need it because I'm going to receive what I'm giving and I'm not giving it, so there's a part of me that doesn't want to receive it. Wow. And then it goes on to say, it's only by answering that person's appeal that you can be helped. Now let me qualify something about that answering call for help stuff, because I have the overview of the whole course where you're just hearing one paragraph of it, so I can bring some other aspects in. You always ask the Holy Spirit before you do anything. So recognizing a person's call for help doesn't mean that you are necessarily the one that's supposed to do something about it unless you're instructed from your inner teacher to do something about it. It could be your help could be the worst thing that ever happened to them. Because we don't really know what's best for someone else.
Yeah.
So the main thing that we're being asked to do at this point is to recognize it. So would y'all be willing to start recognizing it? Even if you're not ready to answer it yet, would you be willing to start calling what you see going on around the world as a call for help? And all the stuff that's going on, there's a lot of stuff going on. Have y'all noticed?
Yeah.
It's a call for help. You know, Brother Robin said, I'm out of here. Yeah. And he got on up out of here. You know what I'm saying? The people are grieving for him, but actually he's grieving for us. Okay, we're the ones that's still here. So, because there is no death, the child of God is free. Who we really are, spiritual beings, we go beyond the body. This isn't it. I'm sorry. I know it's disappointing for some people, but you're going to continue to exist. There's nobody looking at the body in the casket with more wonder than the person that's supposed to be dead. You know.
Didn't he just take with him all this depression? And
what'd you say?
So didn't he just take with him everything that motivated him to commit suicide? Didn't it just go with him?
Whatever his state of consciousness was, that's what he took with him, because that's the only thing that we ever take with us is our state of consciousness. And our state of consciousness is going to recreate whatever our next experience is. But don't forget, he has the Holy Spirit with him, has God with him, has support with him. So no matter what state he left in, he still has love and support and healing coming his way. Yeah, so that would be my impression, that whatever your consciousness level is, that's what you are born into, and that's what you leave. You know, in case you were wondering why you were born, where you were born, how you were born, with what you were born with, it was your own consciousness. That's where you were born, how you were born, when you were born.
Yeah. Ironically, like his movie, What Dreams.
Yeah, What Dreams May Come is my favorite movie by him. You know, so if you ever get a chance to see that movie, it's called What Dreams May Come. And the movie is about what happens after you make your transition. Isn't that interesting? He had a movie out that the whole movie was he died, and then what happened to him after he died.
And the state of consciousness.
And it was all about the same thing. It was all about the state of consciousness. Really interesting that he actually, in a sense, is living out his own role in the dream. So the Course in Miracles says that if you deny somebody else your help, it says you won't recognize God's answer to you. The Holy Spirit doesn't need your help in interpreting motivation. The Holy Spirit doesn't need, what does that mean? The higher power doesn't need your help in interpreting where everybody's coming from. It's not like the higher power checks and say, hey, Brother Earl, what do you think they're thinking over there? I need you to tell me what's going on down the street.
Yeah.
You know, the Holy Spirit, the higher power, doesn't need us, according to the Course, to help it in interpreting motivation. But it says, well, we do need the higher power's help in interpreting motivation. And we just got it, didn't it? Because we were told that everybody's motivation is what is coming from love, or there's a call for love. And that certainly wasn't my interpretation of motivation. That was an interpretation of motivation that was given to me. So spirit doesn't need your help in interpreting motivation. And it's also saying if you deny another person your help, you won't recognize God's answer to you. If I'm always denying love and therefore not in touch with love, then I wouldn't recognize love if it showed up in my life. Most people are surrounded by love that they never even see, because they don't even know what love looks like based on their childhood experiences, the relationships that they've had, and the things that they've created for themselves in the world, that they can be standing right in front of love and never see it. Be standing right in front of the nicest person, most loving person, and never see them. Why? Because I see lack, I see fear, I see abuse, I see what's missing. That's what I'm looking for. So I don't see the love, because I'm always looking at the stuff to be afraid about. Got it? So again, are you noticing that everything about this is trying to build up our awareness of love so that we can allow ourselves to experience it? And it's teaching us how to use all of the trauma and all of the conflict and things that are happening around us to actually empower us instead of making us frightened. Because if I see it as a call for love, then I'm being reminded of love, so I'm being reminded of the truth, and wherever I focus on is what I experience, and so therefore I'm filling my consciousness with the idea of love, and so more love starts to come into my experience.
Mm.
Because what it is, and what's happening is what's happening.
Right.
So either I can look at it in a way that makes me more afraid, or I can look at it in a way that wakes me up. But it's happening. So that's our choice. Okay, any questions about that paragraph? Yes.
So is recognizing a call for help or a call for love, is that the same as feeling compassion or empathy?
I don't think in the context of what the course is talking about, because there are plenty of people who say they feel compassion and empathy, but they don't see that as recognizing somebody has a call for love. It's almost like, I need to see that that person just went off and they're cussing everybody out and everybody else is mad at them for what they're saying. But you're walking in going, wow, that person really has a call for help. They're really afraid. They really have a call for healing. They really have a call for compassion. They really need some understanding. You see what I'm saying? That's different walking in a place and not attacking a person because you see what they're doing as a call for love and just walking in and saying, I have empathy. One is more proactive, you know, if you choose to do that. But remember now, it's not like a person's not going to be helped unless you help them. God is not that limited. So don't think if you don't do it, it ain't gonna happen. If you don't help them, it's not gonna happen. That's the kind of appeal that appeals to a caretaker. And a caretaker is a person who's always trying to fix and take care of everybody in order to raise their own self-esteem. That's not the same as really being a really caring person. So there's gonna be plenty of instances where all Spirit is asking you to do is see it correctly as a call for help. That's all you're being required to do. Plenty of time, which should be good news.
That is good.
It is to me. That's good news to me.
Yes. Which then inspires for me the emotion of compassion and empathy, knowing that they're like needing understanding, that they're needing help, and they're needing
Exactly. Then you're creating a reality that when you're afraid, that's what you'll attract to you. Think about it. The people that I'm surrounded by in my personal life, they would see me being afraid as a call for love, I believe. And wouldn't attack me, but that's because I worked on my consciousness long enough to attract those kind of people. I didn't expect them to just show up without me changing my mind, you see. So who is over here?
I was just gonna say, if somebody is attacking me, it's hard for me to see that as a call for love because I become afraid and so I have to go within the minute I feel that and ask the Holy Spirit.
Exactly. When it looks like somebody's attacking you, it's hard to see it as a call for love.
Right.
That's why you start to practice on the people who aren't attacking you first.
Right.
Right? You practice on the people who look like they're attacking somebody else.
Right.
Or who look like they're hurting somebody else. Because you're going to be the last one. It's like in many classes I've said in the past, when you hear stuff about forgiveness, don't start with the hardest person. And that's what people do. They'll try to start with the person that molested them when they were 5 years old. They go straight to that. Or they go straight to Hitler. You know, it's like, you know, try the person that accidentally stepped on your foot in line.
Yeah.
Or the person, start off with the person who skipped in front of you to buy a ticket to your favorite show. Don't start with the person that you got the greatest grievances with, because if you start with the person that you got the greatest grievances with, it will justify your not doing it.
Right.
And you just not even try the whole thing. So don't be fooled by go to the most extreme situation first and try to see it as a call for love. You mean the people who were bombing the children over there in Palestine as a call for love?
Yeah.
You know, I should see them as a call for love? Start out with the person that stepped on your foot. Mm-hmm. Got it?
Yeah.
Because it's a trick when you try to start with the most difficult. See, one of the things I want to invite you to do after doing the course 35 years is this. It's not complicated. And that's the biggest problem with the material, is that it's not complicated. Everybody in here, everybody in sixth grade can understand it's love or a call for love. See it that way, but you don't always have to do anything about it. What you focus on, that's what you're going to experience more in your consciousness. And what you experience more in your consciousness is what you're going to attract more in your life. Now, all of us can understand that. Everything else is just trying to come up with a reason not to do it. Because we totally understand what I just said. Just like what it was just telling us. If I have a desire not to do that, and I have a desire to see what people are doing as anything other than a call for help, then I'm going, yes, but, yes, but, yes, but, yes, but. But I'm yes, but, because I still want to attack. I still have an imagined need to be angry about something or that person. You with me on that?
Yes. Yeah.
So then you know that you need to work on forgiveness.
Yes.
Because that's why you don't want to do it. But check this out. But who you're really trying to make sure is attacked is yourself. Because you're creating the consciousness that will not create compassion for you when you're afraid and upset. So the main person you're trying to keep out of the loop, or the circle of atonement as the Course calls it, is yourself when you don't practice the truth. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna take one more and then I'm gonna go further.
Yeah,
I'm gonna do you and you. Go ahead, Chris.
So when you were saying about like not recognizing like love being all around you and you're not recognizing it. My experience has been that like also I don't recognize love because of my insistence that love show up in a way of my choosing.
Right.
And it has to do with the form. Like I insist on it that it show up in a certain form. And then I don't see the love that's all around me.
Right.
Because of that.
Right. Well, that's the biggest problem with everything that we want. Is that we make the form of what we want or the appearance of what we want more important than the content. You know, if you really wanted love and you gave it up to spirit and you knew spirit knew exactly who would be the best person for you to connect with, you could probably have that person show up in your life next week. But we don't do it that way. We decide exactly everything about them and how we think it should be, and we decide on the person, and then we try to fit them into whatever this fantasy that we have about what we want them to be, rather than to allow spirit to draw the person to you that can really love you just the way you are. You know, because you'll be going, well, suppose they ugly. Well, see, that's not. Oh, I know you all would all just love to go out with the Hunchback of Notre Dame. Everybody in here is on a level of consciousness that looks does not matter to y'all. I know you're just so spiritual. But the truth is, there's no such thing as being with someone you love who's not beautiful to you.
That's right.
I'll say it again. There's no such thing as being with somebody you love who's not beautiful to you.
Yeah.
Your love will make them beautiful.
Oh, that's true.
You must be a Leo. All you have to do is say love to Leo. And they go, am I not right?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. Yeah. See, that's the way consciousness works. You know what I mean? I was dating a girl in high school one time and I came in the bedroom and my sister had took the picture I had of her on the dress and turned it face down. And I said, would you turn that picture face down? And she said, she's just so ugly. How could you have somebody on your dress like that? And I was like, she didn't look like that to me. I did not see that at all until we broke up. And she looked like the Wicked Witch of the West, the Wizard of Oz. But y'all know what I'm talking about. You probably had the same thing happen. While you were enamored, wasn't anything they could do that could upset you, right? They could pick their toes at the dinner table and you go, oh. You know, and 6 months later, you chop it off with an axe and they put it up there. You know what I mean? Depending on how you feel about a person, it depends on how they look to you. How they look to you and how you relate to them is based on how you feel about them. Yeah, your perception, absolutely. Brother Naeem, you had a question come in?
Yes, first of all, I'm glad to be back with the Denver family.
Yeah!
I just a comment when you mentioned that if you don't want compassionate people in your life, then don't be a compassionate person. Just reminded me of the part in the Course that said, the only thing that's missing in any situation is what you're not giving. So
the statement in the Course that says the only thing that's lacking in any situation is what you're not giving.
I love that.
But in that particular context, it's true, period. But in that particular context, he was talking about faith. That the only thing that's lacking in any situation is what you're not giving, and what you're not giving is faith in God. Faith in the truth. That's what I'm not giving. I'm not giving my faith. And that's what's lacking in the situation. And also it can be true that what's lacking in any situation is what you're not giving, period. Right? Okay. All right, let's go to the next paragraph. Now, what should we do in a situation where it looks like a person has a call for love? It says only appreciation is an appropriate response to your brother. So the only thing I should be having for anyone is appreciation no matter what they're doing. That seems like a tall order, doesn't it? Doesn't it? Okay. Why should I be grateful? It says, because gratitude is due the person for both their loving thoughts, but you should also be grateful for their appeals for help, which you call them going off for being less than loving. He says, why? It's because of what I said earlier. Both are capable of bringing love into your awareness. If you perceive it correctly, you're still being made aware of love. I'm being aware that this is a call for love, that this is a call for help. Why am I harping on this? Why am I saying this over and over and over again? Because if you were to walk out of the door today and you started to try to apply this, it would cut down so much on your judgment that your life would be a ton more peaceful.
Yeah.
Because what are we doing? We're judging all day, and we like to judge. We love to judge. Tell the truth about it.
Yeah.
We love to judge. Because it says we love to judge because it's our way of trying to convince ourselves that we know what's going on. That's what judgment is about. It makes you think you know what's happening. You walk in, you judge a situation, then as an adult you can say, I know what's going on in that class because I judged it. I know what he's about because I judged him. So judgment is a way of trying to convince ourselves that we know what's going on when the truth is we don't have a friggin' clue what's really going on. For all we know, we could be, you know, like a gnat on the back of a big giant universal elephant's butt. You know what I'm saying? Like if you ever look at an insect that's crawling on your hand, that insect doesn't have the slightest idea that it's crawling on your hand and what you look like and what your name is and that you're sitting in the chair. You see what I'm saying? And so we walk around just as certain as maybe that insect is about what's going on. And we don't have any more awareness than that insect does in the grand scheme of things. We really don't. So how do we handle that? Because that's frightening. The way you handle it is to judge. Then you make up what everything means, and then you act like the meaning you give it is correct, so you can have the comfort of thinking you know what's going on, but you really don't. And then you get accepted like the Course in Miracles that turns around and says, one of your workbook lessons is, I do not understand what anything is for. And you're supposed to say that several times during the day. I do not perceive my own best interests. Because we need to get out of that stupor of thinking that we know what's best for ourselves, especially if you're not happy. That's your proof right there that you don't know. Wow. That's too obvious, isn't it? He says, so, now where does your strain come from? This sounds like this is giving me a little strain. And the Course says, all your sense of strain comes from your attempt not to do just this. I'm feeling resistance right now, Earl. Well, that's your strain because you don't want to do it. That's all your strain is. He says strain is our refusal to practice the truth that we know that we should be practicing. And we call it strain, he says, we also call it illness. That it's our refusal to practice the truth that all of us know, which is that we're all one and that love is the only answer. We all know that. He says, but the strain comes from us trying to come up with every solution other than caring and joining and loving each other. That's the solution that we all come up with. Anything but love. What are the leaders on TV saying? Anything but love. They're coming up with every solution for every problem other than love.
That's true. Yeah.
And that's the strain.
Yep.
Because we keep trying to do everything but love each other because we feel justified in not doing it.
Uh-huh.
He says, well, that's my refusal to be helped myself. I don't want to see it as a call for help. I don't want to see it as a call for love. It's really deep, man. Mm-hmm. It's really deep. So all your sense of strain comes from your attempts to not do what?
See
this love or call for love. How simple then is God's plan for salvation, which is the same as saying, how simple is love's plan for your healing? There's but one response to reality. What's the response? It's what?
Love.
Love or a
call
for love. Reality evokes no conflict at all. In other words, the truth of the situation is that it's either love or call for love. That's the end of the story. That's what's happening. Then it says, there is but one teacher of reality who understands what it is. So there is a teacher of truth that we all have, a divine teacher, and that part of us, the Course in Miracles says, understands what it is, and the love in us, the truth in us, the God in us, doesn't change its mind about reality because reality doesn't change. See, a person that loves you, a person in a loving mind, a truly loving mind, never changes their mind about you. It's no such thing as having a love that was a real love that changed. So if you think you had a real love with somebody and it changed, you never was really love. It was specialness.
Right.
And specialness changes. You're special to me today, but you're not special to me tomorrow because you didn't act right. Okay, so specialness isn't love. Love is incapable of change. Love never changes. Fear changes, thank God.
Right?
Specialness changes, obviously. But love doesn't change. And so you'll get to a point on your spiritual path that you want more than specialness, because you know how temporary it is, how unreal it is, how much it's based on judgment, how much you can lose it in a second. And most of all, you realize how guilty it makes you feel.
Yeah.
Because most of your guilt is coming. Like, you can use a relationship for being a guilt factory, as I call it, or you can use a relationship as an innocence factory. It just depends on what you want to use it for. But most people use relationships to make themselves feel guilty and not enough because they seem to be displeasing someone in some way, right? So sometimes you feel more innocent before you get into a relationship. Because up until then, there's no one criticizing so much what you're doing to even care. Like, none of you are gonna worry about what I'm doing later on today. I'm not special enough. So that's the price you pay for specialness. Is everybody in your stuff? That went over big, didn't it? So you talk about the specialness stuff, you're guaranteed to hear the crickets in the class. The minute you start talking about love and specialness, you can just watch it, you know, everybody get. Because we know we got a million scripts for everybody that we say we love. And so when somebody says that's not love, we go, makes us feel uncomfortable. Because you know you're doing it. You know, you maybe did it just today, got on somebody's case because they didn't do something you wanted them to do. So when we read this kind of stuff, it's kind of challenging because it sounds like it's talking about me. Be a different thing if it sounded like it was talking about, somebody else. It'd be, but like, you know. So the Course in Miracles then goes on to say, although your interpretations of reality are meaningless in your divided state, in other words, your interpretations of the true are meaningless because you're full of division. He says, we're not full of unity and oneness. We're not integrated. And then it says, God's interpretations remain consistently true. Love's interpretations remain consistently true. Love gives its interpretations to you because its interpretations are for you. So our Creator, we're being given these interpretations because these interpretations are for us. And it says, don't attempt to help the brother in your way, for you cannot help yourself. Stop trying to help people in your way because you can't even help yourself. Stop trying to help people in your way. 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 Stop trying to help people in your way because you really, if you be honest, the Course is telling us, you really haven't been too successful at helping yourself. Or you being an ecstatically happy, joyful, loving being. So you're helping you as it were. As a matter of fact, me focusing on you is the way that I try to make sure I don't deal with myself. That's why I'm so caught up in your business and not mine, because I don't want to look. Nothing is harder than being alone with your own thoughts if you don't love yourself. So you got to distract yourself through other people so that you won't hear what you're thinking. The Course in Miracles says that's why we're so busy all the time, because if we were ever quiet, we would hear how we think. And so we try to make sure every moment of the day is filled up with anything to keep me from taking a good look at myself. And that's why we said we like to be so busy. Because if you're busy, you can't focus in on what you're thinking, especially if you're busy and it's based on somebody else. That's even a greater distraction. All right, so I need a relationship so that I won't look at myself. I need a relationship so that I won't look at myself.
Ouch.
But actually, I have that relationship and I am looking at myself. That's what's really happening. I'm looking at me.
Exactly.
Yeah. You look at your special friend, special partner, you looking at yourself. You looking at the part of you that's most like you, and hopefully you like what you see. Sometimes people don't. But you looking at your own consciousness. Oh no, I'm not. I'm much more conscious than my partner. No, you're not. That's why they're your partner. That's why they're your friend, because you are like you. What does that mean? They're either expressing what?
Love or call for love.
That's why you're alike. And you're expressing either love or call for love. So you're just alike. So I would advise you, at least if you're going to be in a relationship with anybody, I would advise you to like them. Sometimes people don't get into relationships because they want to experience love. They get into a relationship because they don't want to be alone, mm-hmm. or they want a body, or they want security, or they just want sex. Yeah, thank you. Everybody's looking at me like, say, what the hell is that? For some of y'all, it just might have been that long. But it's the truth. But, you know, some people just have physical attractions. And that's it. And then they try to make it into something else other than that so they won't feel like they're morally lax. Right? So I'm going to make it into something even though really I just have a physical attraction, and that's where the trouble comes in. It's not based on anything real. So if you would be honest with yourself and just say, I'm doing whatever I'm doing because that's what I want to do, it would create a lot less drama for you than for you to make up that it means something than it, more than it really does, because you're trying to seem like you have such high standards. Hello?
Hello.
But here your brothers call for the help of who? God. See, that's important. He says a call for the help of love, call for the help of the Creator. It's a call for the help of God, not a call for the help of Earl, unless God instructs Earl to do it. So when you say see everything as a call for God, it's saying see everything as a call for the help of the Creator, which would be a challenge for you if you believe there's no such thing as a Creator to begin with. But that's a whole other thing for you to work on. Okay, that's not what I'm covering today. Okay, I'm talking to the people that takes for granted that they didn't create themselves.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, so what's the benefit of seeing it as a call for God? Then I recognize my own need for the Creator. When I see that you have a need for the Creator, I will recognize my need for love. And I will recognize my need for the Creator. Because that's all I need, that's all I deserve. So, your interpretation of somebody else's needs are your interpretation of your needs. Your interpretation of somebody else's needs, that's your interpretation of your needs. So whatever you think I need, that's what you need. You need to be more unselfish. I need to be more unselfish. You need to be more patient. I need to be more patient. You need to be more giving. I need to be more giving. You need to control your temper. I need to control my temper. You need to be more loving. I need to be more loving. Whatever you interpret someone else's need as being, that's also going to be your need. So I'm going to interpret your need as needing love. I'm going to interpret your need as needing help of God. I'm going to, because that's the interpretation I want the universe to have of my need.
Yep.
So I'm going to see your need is that.
Sure.
See, this is too simple, because everything I'm being asked to do is something that I could do today.
Yeah.
That's the problem with this. You understand what I'm saying? I can't put it off. Uh-huh. I could do this today. Uh-huh. I need you to tell me something, Earl, that I can't do today, because then I just have to admit I don't want to do it.
Right. Or that you have to buy it.
Yeah, I have to buy it, I have to fight it, I have to work hard for it. So that's why, it's easier to answer calls for love if you try to surround yourself as much as you can with people that you like and you appreciate. So I stack the deck in my favor. I hang out with people I really love to be around. So it's easier for me to want to see what they do as a call for love. People who are fearful surround themselves with people who upset them all the time and then don't spend time with the people they like. Because they think spiritual growth is always trying to get yourself to love somebody you don't like. So they go from one person to another that they have a problem with, that they're trying to see differently. And they think that's spiritual growth, rather than to invest energy in the relationships where they already have love and then have so much love in them that it just overflows on the people that they can't stand. You just drown them in your love. It's like I have a milkshake that's just pouring over the side of the glass, and then everybody else is drinking the milkshake, but my glass is always full. That's the way it's supposed to be. You're so full that people are just experiencing the overflow of your love, so you're never lacking love at all. You're never giving up anything. You're just so full, you have to. It's like a mama whose breast so full of milk, she's just begging for that child. You know what I'm saying? Because I got more than enough. Not I don't have any, so I'm gonna try to go out and get somebody to give it to me. You know, how am I gonna get you some love and I don't even have any for myself? So you got all these people who don't love themselves looking for lovers. You know, that's cruel. Don't do that. Right. If you don't have nothing to give, don't be looking for, don't be trying to go have a relationship with somebody you don't want to give anything. That's not fair to them. Just trying to get. You know, you innocent. So if you're doing that, what is that? That's your call for love. That's your little juicy call for love. Yeah, that's what we are, aren't we? We are we just little babies of God. We don't know what the hell's going on. We poop our pants every day, don't we? We just don't know. We just need to be cleaned by God every single day. You should see yourself just like an infant right now in terms of your spiritual growth. And go, I'm going to be like a little child. I'm going to take it deeper. I'm going to be like an infant that knows that I need to be changed. And that I can't even feed myself right now, temporarily, until I come into spiritual maturity. A baby can't come here with a preconception of what's going on. They have to be taught. So we need to let go of our preconceptions so that we can be taught, so that we can have what we really want, which is love. Because that's really all you deserve, by the way. So if you just, so he says, by giving help, you're asking for help. And if you perceive but one need in yourself, you will be healed. So if you want to be healed in any area of your life, if you want to be healed in any area of your life, if you want to be healed in any area of your life, perceive that you just have one need. Love.
Love.
I have one need, the truth. I have one need. If I want to be healed, I don't have a lot of different needs. I have one need, the truth, which is love, which is freedom, which is abundance, which is life, light, truth, peace. That's all I want, period, period. The Course in Miracles teaches that the goal you set will create the means for you to achieve it. That you don't have to come up with the means to achieve a goal. Your goal will create the way to achieve it. Now I'll say that again, be with that. That's what I'm talking about. Well, you might want to buy that, put it in your truth cart. It's on sale. Okay, the goal will create the means to achieve itself. So the error we make is that most of us are focused on how we're going to achieve our goal more than we're actually focused on what is my goal, what is my purpose, what do I really want? Ask the average person, what do you want? What do they say?
I don't know.
Right? But they're trying to figure out how to get it. But they don't even know what they want. So the Course in Miracles says, if you will truly focus on your goal and your purpose, it will arrange everything necessary to achieve itself. That's another one. Just think about that. Just be with that for a minute. So if I really have the goal of love, and I'm not kidding around, I really believe Earl deserves love, then the way for Earl to experience love will be given to him. The means are secondary to the goal. And if I have the goal, the means to achieve it will be given. That's the way it works. We're powerful, powerful beings.
What affects that goal?
What affects that goal is whether or not you really want it or not.
Right.
That's the, most people are wanting things sort of.
Yeah.
No passion, no drive, no enthusiasm. You have to want it more than anything else. And so the goal to want more than anything else is the goal of God, the goal of peace, the goal of truth. Because it's going to take care of everything else. Yeah. That's going to handle all the other stuff. So the most important goal is your own peace. Now when I say peace, I don't mean sitting in a cave contemplating your navel. The Course in Miracles defines peace as total fulfillment, complete fulfillment. When you say you want peace, you're saying you want complete fulfillment. Doesn't that sound more exciting? Complete, total fulfillment, that's what peace is. You are satisfied. There is nothing missing. You're just unfolding and evolving and loving and unfolding and evolving and loving, and it's growing and it's extending and it's expanding. That's what it should be like naturally, because everything was created to expand in love and joy. And so all I have to do is get in alignment with that purpose myself, because I'm the only one that's throwing a little clunker in the deal. Is mine not wanting love for me as much as my creator wants love for me? Mine not believing I deserve peace as much as the universe believes that? I'm the one that needs to get on board, because I'm believing that I'm bad or I've done something wrong based on something that happened to me in the past. And the past is over. It's gone. It's over. It's done. So you cannot not let go of what's already gone. And the past is gone, so you can't not let go of it. Right. It's gone. 10-year-old Earl is gone. Except at very specific times. And so I do pull him back in specific moments that would be to my own good. But other than that, he's pretty much gone. He says, remember the loving thoughts. If you're going to do it, remember the loving thoughts about your past. Because the loving thoughts are not past. Mm. Love is always present. So that love that you felt is still here with you. So that's really not focusing on the past. When you're focusing on love, you're really focusing on now. And that's the only thing I want for you. That's the only thing I want for you, is that everything you do this week, everything you do today, be seen as a call for love. When you're most afraid, when you're most angry, when you're depressed, when you're sick, when you think you're alone, I want that to be a call for love that's answered perfectly for you. Would you acknowledge yourself, Holy Spirit, for hearing this much? Whoa! Okay. Tell somebody they're a call for love.
You're a call for love. Everyone is here. You're a call for love. You're a call for love.
Give your darling.
Give your darling. Thank you, baby. Thank you for sharing the financial appreciation, professional appreciation with me. I'm a full-time teacher of the course. Everything I have comes only from God, but God uses channels to do it. So I want y'all to take a minute and hear what I'm saying. Thank you for sharing with me. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you for sharing.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing, darling. Appreciate you. Those of you online, thank you so much. Also for sharing with me. If you'd like to make a financial expression of appreciation, you can go to my website, earlpurdy.com. And if you'd like to have a one-on-one session with me so that I can take the Course in Miracles and my knowledge of astrology and numerology and bring it to the situation in your life, then go to my website. It explains all about it. And I do it in person, Skype, on the phone. So whatever you're going through, I guarantee you it's not original. So why don't you avail yourself of the answers that have already been given? I'm just so special that I think my issue is different from everybody else's, but the truth is, it's not. It's really not. So we're so blessed. We're ridiculously blessed. On Tuesday night, there's the Way of Mastery class at 7 o'clock. And that's a very deep metaphysical spiritual class also. It's all about the same thing, getting us in touch with who we really are and how we can create and have it the way we really deserve to have it, because we're willing now to admit we may not know what all there is to know. That's right. So everything is love or a
call
for love. Okay, anybody want to answer this particular statement? One thing I heard today that I want to remember is, yes.
When you, because even said in the course, you just said, you look upon the past, look upon the parts that bring love, because that way you're not even looking at the past, you're looking at love. And
that's
any
right.
excuse to bring more love into your experience is good. So whether it's the past, whether it's whatever, then look at it with love.
Look at it with love. It's love or call for love.
Call for love.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody, one thing I want to remember that I heard.
When I'm witnessing someone and their call for love and their call for help and their call for understanding, then I'm also bringing that back to myself and knowing that there's a part of me that is a call for love and needs understanding and needs help.
That's right.
Yeah.
All right. Yes.
I can't, wish I could say it, but it's what you said. If I express the goal, it will be the
If I focus on the goal, it will create the means to achieve
it
itself.
It will happen.
If I focus on the goal, it will create the means to achieve itself.
Thank you.
It's in this section of the course called Setting the Goal in chapter 17 in the text. Yes.
I deny myself love.
I deny myself love. Thank you.
The ultimate goal is love.
That's what I really want. If I go for the truth, I'll have everything else covered. That's why I want to go for the highest goal possible. Thank you. Anybody else?
I think the most practical thing is that whatever you can do now.
Whatever I can do, that's right.
Just start.
That's right. That's right. There's a line in the course where it says that you can always tell when it's the higher power that's directing you to do something, because it will always be something you're capable of doing now. And you can do it. You'll be totally adequate to fulfill it, and you'll be able to do it right now, which to me sounds like an intelligent being.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, to me it sounds more intelligent to ask you to do something that you want to do and can do than to ask you to do something that you can't do and you don't want to do it anyway. You know, so it's always good to go in the direction of where you see a total yes coming to you from your experience, if at all possible. Anybody else hear something they want to say?
Stop trying to help people in my way because I can't even help myself.
Stop trying to help people in your way because you can't even help yourself. To me, it's relaxing when I hear stuff like this.
Yeah.
You know, to me, it makes me go, oh, good.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Woo, that's good news. Yeah, yeah. Anybody else? Yeah, my brother.
I only have one issue and God has already solved it.
Yeah, you only have one issue. The answers are already available. I just need to avail myself to it because I don't really have an original problem. There is no original problem. You know, like in any counseling that I do, it's always five areas that the problem is in that the person is talking about. It's either they're going to say they got a problem with their relationship, or they're going to say they have a money problem, or they're going to say they have a problem with their job or their career, you know, or they're going to say that they have a health problem, or last, but usually least, is a spiritual problem.
It's all
the
spiritual problem.
Yeah, it's all the spiritual problem. So the course has already answered all of those issues and how you deal with them. So you don't have anything that you couldn't get another way to look at right now if you really wanted it. And so you must ask yourself, why is it that I don't want it?
Yeah.
And then you want to ask yourself, why do I think what I think? Why did I see what I saw? And why do I react the way that I react? That's what you want to ask yourself over and over again all day. Why do I think what I think? Why did I see what I saw? And why did I react the way I reacted? And you'll get a clear conception of your consciousness and your thought and the way that it worked. So, everything, yes.
No, last thing is, if I perceive but one need in myself, I'll be.
If I have just one need, and what is that one need?
Love,
which is God, which is truth, which is freedom, which is life, which is what's real. I need to know what's real. I want what's real. So everything is love or a call for love. It's either 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 love. Or your relationship is either love, or on your job is either love, or what's going on with your body is either love, or a call for love is either love, or a call for love. I appreciate y'all. Thanks for coming out and hearing me tonight, today, this afternoon. You're getting ready to go out into the lab. It's out there waiting for you. Calls for love are just out there. You all can increase so much love in your life today. Just think of how many things out there that you're going to get a chance to see. That's just a call for love. Yay! Hugs are available. I appreciate y'all.
Thanks
for coming out. Thank you, darling.
All right.